Hey everybody, this is Inga from Punk Stylers TV. It's a nice Saturday afternoon. We're chilling in London with Frankie Johnson, also known as Frankie J. You know him from events like Summer and House Dance Forever, SDK, House Dance Europe, and many, many others. And yeah, you know he's a house dancer, but he's a well-rounded dancer as well. And today we're going to talk about his training, his inspiration, his travels, and some other stuff. So thank you very much for spending time with us. So first question. I know from your other interview you mentioned how you grew up with your parents' music, and apart from those influences, your parents in the music, were there other influences in your dance? Maybe there were some events that influenced your dance?
Yeah, growing up, I think one of the major influences was from when I used to take part in youth dance projects when I was a child. Into kind of my early teens, and I was doing a lot of creative and contemporary dance projects with a lot of young dancers based in my home city in Bristol. And for me, I think before I made the transition into learning hip-hop dance styles, my movement vocabulary, or the way that I kind of viewed movement and dance in general, came from a more of a creative background and not necessarily like a style or a dance style. It was just about being able to learn how to be expressive with movement in general. Like before the dance, it was just getting used to expressing with movement. And I think this was probably one of my biggest influences. And then music was just something that I always just had general interest in, because yeah, my mum and my dad, they were really two big people that had helped me to be inspired by listening to different types of music, and they were constantly listening to all genre. So yeah, those things are my main impacts.
Okay, so you are a soloist dancer, but you also belong to a number of crews now. How many crews do you belong to now, and what are their titles?
I represent under Plague Dance Crew, and also Soul Footwork Collective. They're both based in London. Same with Inder House UK, directed by Clara Bajardo. And then I also helped to bring up this, which is the jam movement, which is a movement, or not necessarily a crew, but it's more of a collective of dancers who got together in my home city, who wanted to kind of bring artists and not just dancers, but all people that had an interest in art, graffiti, music, DJing, everything, because Bristol has a really big arts community. So this was kind of something that we wanted to do to try and bring people of arts interest together. And then I've also just been asked to join a collective which is hosted by PJ from Germany, called Quartus Movement, which is a movement which we've decided to put together to basically bring dancers from different countries, from international aspects, and try to bring just people more together through the dance community, but on an international level. Like it's quite a thing, an idea that's already been done before. It's nothing like entirely original, but just that we have an interest of having something like that to bring dancers of the same interest together from different places. And then I'm also part of a crew called Sui Generis,
okay,
based in London.
Okay, I heard about Sui Generis, and I actually saw your performance, guys, at one of Clara's events. So I wanted to ask, what is the meaning behind the name, and why did you guys pick it for the crew?
Okay, so Sui Generis was picked, or decided by all of us, but came up by Joel Glafke, and he thought it would be a great name for us, because it came down to the mentality of the dancers, or the people that he would want to be in this group. And the main idea was that it was about individuals, or being able to show individuality, but at the same time the individuality still has a stem which keeps a certain amount of people connected or stemmed together, so that they share the same ambition, or they share the same outcome or future or pathway, but they still obviously retain this individuality, which also brings them together. And so for us, we were just like, this is really cool. And even for myself, it was the first time I had heard this word, sui generis. So because it was something that I thought that may have not been used before and it sounded really original, we wanted to put it together. And it was purely put together because not to necessarily start like, okay, we're going to do a brand new crew, because I mean there's lots of us and myself that dance with lots of other collectives and groups, but it was just something that he had a big interest in, and from his perspective it's something he could foresee in us, like myself and Troy, Camilla, Dasha, who are the other members of the group, and he could see this for us. So
Okay, so what does the notion of the crew mean to you?
The notion, I would say, is for us to still keep our individuality, but when we come together as a group, we are people that can be directed together in the same direction. And if there's anyone of that interest or anyone that has interest to come to us about that and stuff, we're hopefully thinking that we can be people or representatives that can help in understanding what kind of direction you'd want to go in, no matter what it is, even if it wasn't dance related. And I think that is the main notion, because it's the thing that I see in each of the people that are in the group. That's their strong point. They know, they kind of know where they want to go, and they're very determined. So, using my voice. this is the thing that is really strong in each of the members in the group. Like, you can really see that they're driven by something, and that's what really brings us together.
Okay. So let's talk a little bit about your travels. When and how did you start traveling with dance?
Okay. So the first year I started traveling was in 2012, which was when I first went to Summer Dance Forever in Amsterdam. And the reason behind going was there was a couple of other dancers in London that were going, and I decided to travel there with Wachi, also part of Soulful Collective, and he wanted to come as well, and we just decided it was both our first time trip. Wasn't the first time trip abroad, but it was the first time trip going to specifically go to a dance event or a battle event. And for us it was just a complete mind-blowing experience. I mean, we got to meet so many dancers who we have seen on YouTube, or you know, and also just experience a different culture, a different community. So, you know, seeing dancers of the same styles and the same calibers of what we have been doing in London, but seeing it with new fresh faces and new different people, like, it's always a different experience and fulfilling moment when you've really like seen new people for the first time dance and stuff. So this was like really exciting for us. And then I think I spent the whole week out there, so I got to take some workshops, so I got to learn from some amazing dancers. I remember taking, I think it was Heroes class for the first time, and also Khalif as well. I think it was, it was the same year I took Khalif's class for the first time. So yeah, it was just an overall great experience of learning and just taking in this whole new thing.
Okay, so out of all events that you visited, which one or which ones are most enjoyable to you, and why are they most enjoyable?
Yeah. So, back to Summer Dance Forever, that's the one that I've consistently been going to since 2012, and also House Dance Forever, which was on the same weekend as the Juste Bou Holland qualifier. So for me, this is definitely, like, the reason why I spend so much time at this event is I feel like it's really the birth or the stem of my journey or my progression as a house dancer, because it's the thing where I've always gone there to be re-inspired, to dance, see old and new friends, and it's the thing that has, I feel like, it's given me the push from the beginning, from the get-go. So this is definitely one of my favorites. And then, I mean, I've been to quite a few. I think KOD, when I went to Beijing in 2013, this was another amazing experience. I mean, going to Asia for the first time was really awesome. And that was more about, it was more shocking in a good way from a cultural perspective, because I find that it was completely different to the Western community. And obviously being based in London, it's a very different lifestyle, a very different community. But again, what is so nice is that it's the dancing that unites everybody, and it's the interest that in those dance forms that keeps everyone united. So it's, you still have the comfort of going into something like that. So this was a great experience. And then another really good time that I had this year was when I got invited to be a guest judge battler at Random Circles in Frankfurt, hosted by Dope Rock Crew, Batala, and Kev Boogie. And this was, this was like a really honorable time for me, because it was one of the first experiences of being invited to an international event. And the whole setup of their event was just great. Like they did a big barbecue, and they did a, so that everyone could kind of come and meet each other for the first time before the event. Nice. So it was like an acquaintance kind of party. And then they had the event, and then it was another party after the event. So it was just, it just kind of flowed into one whole thing. And so, and for me, it created such a great atmosphere, because I think sometimes battle events, there's a lot of people that get too caught up in the motion of it being a battle, and they forget to have the fun aspect.
That it's nice that there's a social aspect to events, like a party before, after, and so on, so people can actually, have and fun and different energy, definitely.
Yeah, it just keeps a whole lightheartedness to the whole thing, and it just makes the whole the experience a lot more enjoyable, you know. So yeah, for me, this was definitely a highlight of mine so far.
Okay, so when you go to events to battle, do you feel the pressure and responsibility to represent UK?
I definitely feel pressure, no matter what battle, no matter what experience. no matter what experience and wherever the battle may be, even if it's in London or the UK, I always feel pressure. I think it's just naturally, because I feel the excitement and the anxiety and the excitement of doing the battle. But pressure in a sense of feeling like I'm holding the UK on my shoulders or representing the UK name, it's something I never really think about. Like at times I'm like, if I'm at an event, especially in an international event, and I'm the only UK person here, then I'm looking at myself and I'm like, okay, yeah, like I guess I'm here as the UK representative, as I'm the only UK person here, and I'll do my thing. But I think I don't like to put too much pressure on myself, because I mean, there's so many other dancers in the UK scene that are doing exactly the same as what I'm doing. I'm no one different to think that I'm the UK representative, or I'm just a UK representative, there's so many dancers that are still doing the same thing. I just have to remind myself that I'm just here having fun, I'm just enjoying the dance. And for me, I always feel that makes me perform or do the dance more justice for myself. And I just have to always remember to not take it too seriously.
Okay, so having traveled quite a bit, actually, what can you say about UK dance scene in comparison to some others that you experienced?
I think it's only been a short time that I've really been in the circuit or in the community. I feel that in the short amount of time that I've been in it, I've definitely seen a huge growth, which is really cool. I mean, seeing so many more dancers being involved in wanting to really build the community and get together and create new things so that there's more opportunities for dancers to be involved, whether that's taking class or being involved in a party or an event, in a festival. I mean, there's many different aspects now, even in theatre and performance. Mm-hmm. I think this is really growing. I think one of the things I really notice when I come back from somewhere, and the thing is, what's interesting is, if I mention any problems that maybe the UK scene has, these problems still occur in the other scenes that I go to when I go abroad or go to an international event. It's just because I'm not from there, I can't experience that involvement that they have. So, you know, it's exactly the same on their terms if they came into London. It's exactly the same. Everyone has their own problems. But I feel the one thing that I think that the UK could do more maybe is similar to kind of like this lightheartedness that I was talking about earlier. I think there's a lot of people that take the battles too seriously. And I mean, even though the battle aspect to a lot of dancers now is quite important to them, because they feel like this is one of the only options that they have to really show themselves and who they are in the scene. Mm-hmm. And they feel like this is the main avenue where they can get their popularity, or they can what's the word?
Get the name?
Yeah, get the name or seek a name. But you know, so many dancers in particular have told me, you know, the battle scene is like the size of your pinky fingernail, and the rest of you is the rest, is the whole other form of what the dance is about. And it's really true, like the battle scene is really tiny in accordance to the dance itself and what is involved in learning about a dance form or the culture behind the dance form. And it's something that I'm still learning and still trying to understand as I mature as a dancer and as I mature in age as well. So this is something I think the UK could learn a lot more from, is that a sense of building the community together and not having too many enemies, but also having some enemies is in some eyes what people will think is good to have, because it keeps the competition alive. But I mean, it's at the same time, it's just dancing. Mm-hmm. It's just dancing, you know. And so, you know, you can't be too serious, can't be too angry at someone for just trying to enjoy dance, you know.
That's true. So if you could exchange with anyone in the world, who would it be and why?
So this is a really difficult question, but for me, I think, as I was thinking earlier, I think the Nicholas brothers are a great option, or it would be a great opportunity to exchange with, even to talk to, a talking exchange as well as dancing exchange, because there's a lot of the aspects in their dance, their footwork especially, is something that really, really gets me excited or interests me a lot. I have a big love for footwork, and it's from them, it would be a complete honor to even just to be in the presence of when they're dancing, because you can, even when you watch them on the screen, or you know, you watch them in the old time movies, is that the impact that they have or the energy that they give off screen, on screen, is just crazy. So if they can do that much behind a screen, and if it was in real person, I couldn't imagine the life that they give when they dance. So yeah, for hands down, they would be definitely in the top people to be able to exchange with, for sure.
Yeah, that would be amazing. I've seen you at some events in London, like Shiftless Shuffle, and for the people who don't know, it's London Jazz Night, or Day, actually. Yeah, so I wanted to ask you, are you involved in the UK jazz dance scene?
So me, I wouldn't classify myself being involved entirely in the UK jazz scene. My knowledge of the UK jazz is very small, but through mentorship and working with dancers who are involved in the UK jazz scene, and from what they've taught me so far, it's definitely something that heavily influences me in the way that I think about dance, and also how I dance as well. like even when it comes to just the most basic things, like learning a couple of steps, mm-hmm. but also doing my research and understanding what has been implemented in the UK by UK jazz dancers, so the history, and this is stuff that really interests me even more and more, and I'm just starting to gather more information, and I'm taking it upon myself to approach the dancers who have this knowledge. And what we're very lucky to have here in London is that when we have nights like Shift the Shuffle, and the dancers who were lucky to say that are still about and are still mm-hmm. dancing and originally come from the first generation of that scene, they're there at these nights for people like myself to engage with, mm-hmm. even if that means engaging in dancing, but also in discussion. You know, they're more than happy to talk to somebody who has an interest in wanting to know about something that they've done and helped to build. Mm-hmm. You know, people like, I'll mention Irvin Lewis, mm-hmm. he's been someone who's been mentoring me for a long time, and someone who has watched me grow in my house dance and other dance forms. And what's so great about him is that a lot of people here know him as a photographer, but his dance history, his dance entity is huge. Some people don't understand that this is the thing he was doing before any of that. And it's just exciting when you see him hit the floor, he's so explosive, like he's full of energy. I don't think there's ever going to be a time where I'll never see that guy not dance. Like, it's just, yeah, he's always dancing. And another honorable mention I'd like to say is Gary Nurse as well. Mm-hmm. Gary Nurse is someone who isn't actively as dancing as much, but when he gets to come to events and stuff, he's always really supportive of myself and other dancers. And he really is someone that seeks to try and help me innovate and to be inspired and be influenced in the movement that comes from UK jazz. And he's so active in being able to direct dancers, whether it comes to like commercial work and mm-hmm. to underground avenue work as well. Big respect to them too, because they're the two dancers who have really taught me a lot about mm-hmm. UK jazz, even if it's like this much, but for mm-hmm. me it's a lot, because it's something that I'm always able to hold on to and cherish, even if that's small information. Mm-hmm. And if you're going to watch the interview and you get to watch it before next week, Gary Ness is teaching a UK jazz workshop at Studio B, part of the B Supreme course, that takes place on Tuesday. I think that's the 22nd of July. And he's going to be teaching the UK jazz workshop. So that is going to be great if people can hit that up. It's a really good opportunity to learn more about the movement.
Yeah. So, you know, you, as I said in the beginning, you are a well-rounded dancer. You've done classical, you've done contemporary, popping, locking, house, a bit of jazz, UK jazz. Are there any other dance styles that you would like to learn?
One dance form I'm taking upon myself to learn a little bit more and more is tap. tap dance, again, it comes from the love of footwork, but also a good friend of mine, one of my best friends, and also who I dance with and play dance crew, called Dharmesh Patel, mm-hmm. Tap Dharms. He is someone who has highly inspired me in being able to integrate tap with my house dance, and different ways of implementing steps that, you know, occasionally me and him will exchange and we'll practice together, and then he'll give me an idea and then I'll give him an idea, mm-hmm. and so he can transfer some of the information that I give to him into his dance and vice versa. He's someone who's really kind of excited me into this dance style more and more and more, because he's someone who I would say has innovated tap in the sense that he allows his freedom to still be within it, and he really shows the Dharmesh part of his tap. He's not just an average tap dancer or a jazz tap dancer or a classical tap dancer. Like, it's very his own style. Like, he's very individual in the way that he does it, and he, you know, he integrates it with his locking and his popping and everything else that he has. So for me, it's just, it's inspiring when you can work with a dancer or dance with somebody like him that has that much freedom within a movement like that, or a set movement like that. So this is one style that I'm getting more into. Mm-hmm. And another dance style. that I would get into. No, I think I'm really I think I'm happy with where I am with that at the moment. I think there's a lot of dance forms that really take my interest, but I don't think I could physically put myself into it. Like, yeah. I love watching crump.
Uh-huh.
Crump is such an expressive movement, especially when you can really see when someone is like really mm-hmm. in the moment, and you can really tell where that story or that narrative or whatever mm-hmm. it is, that message that they have to express, you can really see it. And for me, that's really inspiring, mm-hmm. in the sense that I would love to feel that I could learn by transferring that understanding of really letting go the message that you have,
mm-hmm.
Because there's a lot of avenues in the dance, like battles and contests, where it's kind of difficult to do that sometimes, because you feel like you're under the pressure of mm-hmm. having to just throw moves at people or throw combos or something like this in a limited amount of time. But it's crump, I feel it's one of the dance styles where it really can actually teach you about inhabiting the moment of what you're feeling right there and then, and then being able to tell it out in a physical message. And this is something I think you could definitely transfer into other dance styles, but it's just about figuring out how that release works for you.
Mm-hmm.
And so for me, that's something that inspires me, definitely.
Yeah.
Sure.
Okay, so in one of your other interviews with Step by Step Dance, you mentioned your condition, synesthesia. So I wanted to ask you, when did you... Synesthesia is basically when you experience the colors when you...
Yeah.
Like, there's different forms, but yes. Frankie does it when he sees colors when he hears music, basically. So I wanted to ask you, when did you experience this first, and when did you realize that most of other people don't really have it?
I can't remember exactly the first time I feel like I've experienced it, but again, one of the mentions that I had spoken with in the interview with Step by Step Dance was this time where I had battled Adam from Soyest Crew
mm-hmm.
in Poland
mm.
at Can You Rock Me? And this was a moment where I felt like I could see that, and it was one of the songs that we danced to. I think it was the first round song. It was the first time hearing that song, but instantly when I heard the music, it was weird. I could just see colors, like blemishing in my thoughts, in my mind. So it was kind of like, at the time of dancing, it felt like I was able to really just let my body move in its own way, in the sense of it not me having to think about exactly what it was that I was going to do
mm-hmm.
in that round. But it was the understanding of the music and the colors and the feeling that I had right there and in that moment, which is I felt like had driven my dance, because there was things in that round which threw me off. When I looked at it back, I was like, wow, I don't usually move like that.
Mm-hmm.
And so I feel that is definitely one of the... I'm hoping that's definitely one of the reasons behind why I moved like that in that particular round, because I felt like it was a really good round for me in general, but also like it was also a time where I felt like my dance was driven differently.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't driven by the thought of like, okay, I want to do this, or I want to try and attempt that, or I want to try and, you know, have this kind of feeling. Like, I didn't really have to think about what was going to happen in that moment. It just felt like it happened, and it was through this colourful moment that I had, I think. I explained in the interviews that I was seeing things like purples, and I was seeing blues, and like sky blue colours and stuff like this. And funny enough, what I also had explained is that in the background of the video, there was this kind of like blue neon light in the back of like behind the DJ, where DJ Combat was playing.
Mm-hmm.
And even though I say it, it might just sound like, oh, you're just saying that because there was actually a blue light in the background and stuff, but it was kind of I think it was the kind of the atmosphere of the space as well, because it may have been quite dark and stuff, and it was a nightclub, that it gave me this kind of mood or this feeling.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I think it's a number of reasons why in that particular moment that happened. But I mean, it only happens sometimes, and it happens with song, and it's, I think it's the music or it's the songs that trigger it sometimes.
And do you get that with voices or other sounds or just music?
I think music. I've only really experienced it with music.
Okay. Have you met any other dancers with the same condition?
Not entirely exactly the same, but there, like you said, there was different versions. People get it through just feeling. They have a feeling when they hear something or they see something, and it's through that that they experience synesthesia. And also it was Stephanie, the girl that interviewed me in Step by Step Dance. She had explained to me she's had experiences of seeing or having an emotion take over in that moment of hearing something or seeing something. So when I had that discussion with her, it was quite easy to explain it to her, because she felt like she could really understand and relate to it. But I can almost guarantee there must be so many people that really experience it, because there's especially in dancers, because when you find when someone's really in the moment of something, like it's there's a difference. You really see a difference when someone is trying to be in the moment, or not trying to be in the moment, but they have to force the situation. Compared to someone who is the situation or is in that moment, you know, and it really has. There's a level difference. There's a massive level difference I feel when you see it. So this for me is the significant of being able to witness that or for that to happen to you.
Okay. I know you're really, really busy and you're teaching all the time, classes and workshops. What is the main thing that you're trying to get across to your students when you teach?
Yeah. So, like anybody else, I like to hope to think that I can pass on the information that has been given to me, understanding the history and the foundation of dance style that I'm teaching, mainly house. Again, my interpretation, my style isn't originally house. It's an interpretation of what's been given to me and how I've learned house dance, and also the way I've integrated my other experiences of dance styles that I've learned in the past. And I think that's why I love house dance so much, because for me it's a dance style that really welcomes interpretation, welcomes influence, and welcomes the freedom that that other dancers, that other forms of dances can you know flourish within it as well. For me, I just want one of my messages to the students is to not be afraid to really let go and show themselves within the dance, the personality. And I feel that for me, when it comes to really being in the 100% expressing that form of dance, the most important thing is to allow yourself to be you, and not to be too formed by technique or to be too be formed by the vocabulary too much. Because for me, I see it as like tools, like in a toolbox. And I say this to students that I teach. I say that your pockets are like your toolboxes. And when you learn new things from class, these are new tools that you can add to your toolbox. And you know, those toolboxes are things that you can carry with you wherever you go, to the next thing you want to mend, or the next thing you want to try build. And it's the building which is related to the tools. You know, when you start to manipulate and use the tools, you're building new things, you're building a new structure. And so the structure, in a sense, I see it as is new ideas and movement, or it's tricks, or it's whatever you want to see it as. It's just being able to build your understanding of this form of dance more and more and more. Again, this is for me one of the most important messages that I like to pass over, because again, whatever I'm teaching isn't right, but it also it isn't wrong. It's just the way that I love to do this dance, and what's really nice is I really appreciate that people really like what I do, and really enjoy the way that I interpret this dance style. So for me, if people really enjoy that and want to learn from me, like me, I'm more than happy mm-hmm. to share and to give back to the people, because as well, this is another reason why I teach and want to give to people, is because so much has been given to me. Mm-hmm. And I've come from a place where there's not too much information being passed down to mm-hmm. dancers who have a high interest or really want to pursue something in dance. And so, you know, I feel this is one of my main jobs that I feel like I'd want to do or want to represent, is that I'm somebody who can pass on to somebody else, you know. Mm-hmm. As I feel that's the thing where the next generation of dancers or the next people who want to be involved in this community, that, you know, they take what we have and they up it. They just keep improving it and making it better. So, mm-hmm.
So you're talking about people being themselves and people building, you know, from that toolbox. But what's your advice on how to be free in dance, how to find that freedom? Because a lot of people, they can do, and as you say, you know, like they, you can see when a person really feels something and when a person is trying to feel something. But what would your advice be on how to find that freedom?
So finding freedom for me is even a 50-50 thing for me, because it's something I'm still really trying to mm-hmm. take a grasp on myself. And I think it's something that I'm forever going to have to try and fight, mm-hmm. because it's one of the hardest things to be free within a dance style, or be free in a moment where you can really believe in the thing that you're expressing. And again, similar to what I just said before, like you really have to allow yourself to come through the dance, more importantly than the actual steps and the technique and everything else. Because mm-hmm. For me, that's after. Mm-hmm. To have self-belief, you have to have self-belief. Mm-hmm. I feel like one thing I say to a lot of people is that even if you were to do the most simplest movement by maybe just doing this, but knowing that there's belief behind this mm-hmm. point, or being able to really put 100% devotion into something, mm-hmm. for me that's what is the capture of being able to really take in and understand what someone's doing is when someone is in that 100% belief right there and then. And if you're able to do that comfortably, then for me, freedom, when the freedom after, is going to be a lot more easier to be able to really engage into, because it's like the confidence that we have in normal daily things. Like, it sounds mm-hmm. silly, but even when you do like normal daily things about, like, you know, getting changed, going to take a shower, brushing your teeth, like these are day-to-day things that we do, but naturally we have a confidence in doing them because we know how to do them so well. Mm-hmm. And it's the same thing that I kind of see in being able to believe behind the movement that you have. Mm-hmm. If you can have that same kind of same dedication behind your movement, in the same way that you have the dedication to brush your teeth or shower, because you know what you're doing, it's the same in movement, or it's the same in dance. If you know what you're doing and you believe in whatever it is that's going to happen right there and in that moment, then it's going to work out in the same way, because again, there's no right and there's no wrong. It's just you. It's your interpretation of it. And if you have that belief, your freedom's really going to just be like, it's going to open. Don't let yourself be put off by judgment as mm-hmm. well. Judgment is a really big thing, or criticism, or what somebody has to say about your dance. And at the same time, there's going to be people that won't necessarily enjoy your dance, mm-hmm. and that's just one thing we have to live with. Like, not everyone is going to enjoy your style or the way you see it or the way you do it, but at the end of the day, that's what makes you an individual, or that's mm-hmm. what makes it yours. There's no point trying to cater to the people who don't like your style and try and make them like it, because you're then having to change yourself, and for me that's not freedom. Mm-hmm. Freedom is that you allow yourself to just do it in the way that you want to do it, and it will happen.
That's so true. Thank you. One of the questions from Funkstylers TV followers: how often do you train, and for how long?
So I think if I'm right, I must dance nearly at least every day, mm-hmm. every day. Or if I'm not dancing every day, I'm thinking about dance every day. I'm like a dance addict. But in statistics, I'd say maybe, I like to think maybe I train anything in between 12 and 15 hours a week, mm-hmm. maybe. But most days I'm either rehearsing or I'm spending time training, and I also live in a household where I live with other dancers, so yeah. Dance is always one of the topics that's always been brought up in the house, or even going to the Charing Cross sessions in London, where there's different dance sessions every day, uh-huh. I'm at most of those, and then you have the dance nights as well, yeah. during the week and on the weekend, so it's a lot of dancing. And I wouldn't consider like going out or being at home, I wouldn't call it like training, but I mean my constant engagement with dance, even if it's about thinking about it or physically doing it, mm-hmm. I always feel that it's always progressing me. Mm-hmm. Even doing this interview, talking about dance and my journey and what I've done so far is also always teaching myself about how much I've already done and how much more there is to do and to experience. And it's something that I think is one of my main drives to always try and better myself. It's the thing that always is like always telling me like, okay, what's the next thing, like what do you want to do next, you know. And if you always have that kind of outlook to it and keep a positivity about it as well by enjoying it, if you know if you don't enjoy it, that's always a hard thing. It's always a really hard thing. If you don't enjoy it, then it's going to make your journey a lot more difficult. But if you really enjoy what it is you do, no matter how hard you work, it's always gonna propel you forwards, because not everyone has the same limits, you know. There's some people who will progress really quickly by not doing a lot. There's some people who will really progress by doing lots. It just depends what works mm-hmm. for you. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, it alters. I mean, there's times where I really have to sometimes take a week off. I'm like, I need a rest. Uh-huh. And sometimes the rest does me really good because I come back really refreshed mentally as well. Yeah. And I'm like, wow, I've just, you know, I've got these whole new ideas that I want to just put into motion. So it changes from time to time, but I mean I do train a lot. Mm-hmm. I work hard.
Yeah, it's visible. So if you weren't a dancer, who would you be?
Ooh. I'd like to think that it would definitely still be something to do with the arts. Back in my A-level GCSE days, I was doing a lot of art and design, mm-hmm. and also music. So I was doing like music theory and music compilation, kind mm-hmm. of creating mm-hmm. music mm-hmm. as well. because music was a big influence or a big love of mine anyway, possibilities of maybe being a DJ would have been quite cool. Mm-hmm. maybe later in life, I'd maybe try and give it a shot. Mm-hmm. But I definitely think it would be something to do with arts. Something to do with film or music or art and design. Like, just because I feel expression is something I feel my body in whatever aspect of doing it would be good at, because I'm quite, even till now, I'm quite a shy person, but my shyness is really, it disappears when I show it through expression. Mm-hmm. So I think it would definitely be for something that would express myself.
Okay. What do you feel is your biggest achievement in life so far? Not necessarily in dance, generally.
Definitely, one would be gaining my first honours degree in contemporary dance at London Contemporary Dance Theatre. That's a really big thing for me. That would definitely be up there. Also, just where I am at the moment, it's weird saying it because I never really think about it or say that I'm proud of myself for doing it, but yeah, I'm just really kind of proud of the journey I've taken so far. and with the choices that I've made, because it's been a really short period of time where I've been active, you could say. But I mean, I'm really happy with how things are turning out at the moment, and I'm just doing my own thing and just having fun with it and seeing whatever happens, whether something bad happens or good happens. I'm always trying to see the light of it, you know, or the positivity of it. I think this is something that's going to be like an ongoing proud moment. It's just something, no matter what happens, I'm always going to be proud of the journey that's happened so far. Within that, and whether that, and that's speaking of dance and non-dance things, mm-hmm. too. Is there anything else? I'm really happy with everything. Yeah, I'm in a very lucky and blessed position. And even to say I'm proud that I'm able to make something like dance be something that I'm able to do as an occupation as well,
yeah.
Do as a job, and very lucky to be able to live off as well, because there's a lot of people who I come across who always tell me, you know, you're very lucky, and I would absolutely die to be able to live off something that they would love to do or do as a hobby or whatnot. And so, you know, when people tell me that, it always reminds me that I am very lucky to be able to do it, and just to keep continuing to work hard and keep just having fun as well. You have to have fun with it.
That's true. Okay, and final question for me: if you had the ability or had the chance to have one superpower, what would it be and why?
Ooh, one superpower. That is a really hard question. I think the first thing that came in my head, but now thinking about it, I think it would be a bad idea. I was about to say, have the power to get rid of all negative things, but I think getting rid of all negative things would cause imbalance. I think it would be a bad idea if I did that. But I don't know. I think it's not really an original one, but I think reading minds can be quite dangerous. But I think at the same time, I think sometimes I find myself, I'm a little bit ditzy in the way that I don't really take in someone sometimes, in the sense of really understanding how a person feels at times. And I'd like to think if I could read somebody's mind at a time where I felt like it was appropriate to do that,
mm-hmm.
without invading like their personal personal, you know, space and stuff, like,
yeah.
It being able to help somebody in a difficult situation by reading and understanding what's going on in their situation would be really cool. I think, yeah, I'm really interested in helping people, so I guess that's what a superhero does. But it would be something, again, similar to being able to give back to someone. If they were ever stuck in any trouble or situation, then that is how I would hope to resolve it.
Okay. And that's Frankie J for you guys. Do you have any final comments, shout outs?
Just a big shout out to all the people that I represent. So Plague, Soul Footwork, Inderhouse, Soy Generis, Quarter Movements. Big shout out to Front Sellers Television for inviting me to do this interview. Really appreciate it.
It was nice to talk to you. I've been wanting to do that for a while.
And big shout out to everyone who's watching the video. I hope you've enjoyed a little bit of my journey. I hope to continue the journey and keep it ongoing and strong, and more exciting things to come.
Guys, thank you very much for watching this interview. If you want more content like this, go on our YouTube page, we're on Instagram, we're on Facebook, we're on Twitter, we're everywhere, Funk Stylers TV. Till the next time.